other thing I could have done, because I'm going to do it like myself, the only other thing I could have done, I would have bought a RV, turned around and came back.
Do you remember them being injured with black dog on that trip, or did you see like a dog go over and swerve, or?
I remember that.
Anything that a witness might tell me that would explain your action?
Tell me what that, tell me that you might have gone on the RV. Tell me, okay, well, tell me about it. I would probably go with those. And then I would return, so.
Alright.
I hate that, I would have been around that one.
You never seen her out of corner of your eye, like an old dog?
I don't remember seeing her out of corner of my eye, so I got honest, I don't remember seeing her.
And you didn't pull the whip off her?
No.
Yes, she is there. You saw her all the time, you saw her talk to kids, and you pulled the whip off her, didn't you?
I know
what happened. I just need to know that your heart was in the right place. Do you hear me?
I don't think that you're a bad guy. I think that you're a good guy. I think that you're a very loving guy. Alright? But I need to know. You said you might have. I need to know. No light up here. This is the time. There's no light up. This is game day. I need to know what to do.
Was it an accident? I mean, did you pull over and talk to an accident here?
Okay.
You want to know what's wrong? Okay.
Store. His girlfriend Bessie went the other direction to our
B's, which is a bar, he's now saying he went to Arby's on the way to Arby's, flashing his girlfriend, waving at him, flagging down, turns the wheel into her, and hits her, turns around, leaves. He's charged with police second degree murder, spends a year in jail, before he is cleared. How is he cleared? Well, the hair on the bumper was not human hair, it was deer hair. The skin marks at the scene where the officer suggested maybe he swerved and hit a dog, the skin marks did not match the tires on the van. There are broken pieces of a mud flap by the crime scene that police officers believe were from the car that hit the woman. Maybe this van doesn't have a mud flap. And the damage to the front of the car, there's really no damage to the front of Raven's van. A few dings, you know, dings and a couple little minor dents, but nothing that you would expect to see when someone is driving 50 miles an hour hits someone. Raven says he went to JD's to get a beer. Well, around the time when this accident happened, there's a video of Raven entering the store, perfectly calm, cool, and collected, buying a six-pack of beer. Raven is innocent. And fortunately, the judge, after seeing this interrogation, does something that many judges today would not do. He suppressed the confession. He found this confession to be involuntary. And he cited the fact that not a single fact in that confession came from Raymond Wood. They were all suggested to him, and in his weakened state, he accepted the suggestions of the interrogator. This was even before the evidence of his innocence got before the court. So Raymond's confession is suppressed. The police officers have no way of proceeding without it. Charges are dropped. A year of Raymond's life has been lost. Describes this process as psychological torture. What is this process? Well, it begins in an interrogation room, and the surroundings are important. Interrogation rooms are supposed to be designed in a particular way. They're supposed to be small. They're not supposed to have anything on the walls, nothing to distract the interrogator from what's going on, from his task at hand, which is to get him. The suspect is supposed to be sort of pushed into a corner with the interrogators in front of him so that for the suspect to leave, he has to feel like he has to go through the interrogators. He has to ask their permission. The doors are closed, there's no natural light in the room, so the suspect can't see the passage of time. He doesn't know how long he's in that room. Day turns into night, that turns into day. He can't tell any of those things. There was a table in front of Raven and the interrogators. They lifted it out of the way. Why do you think they did that? Anybody? Why lift that table out of the way?
The sending of the barrier between them.
Exactly. It creates a physical barrier between them. It prevents them from being able to invade his personal space. Gives him something of support, something he can lean on, something he can rely on to separate him from his interrogators. So they lift it up and put it out of the way, and of course they move in extremely close to him. No one actually touches him, but they get very close to him. The physical surroundings are supposed to increase the suspect's anxiety and make it easier manipulate the suspect's perceptions so that he believes that it's in his best interest to confess. There are no phones in the room. There are no distractions. So the room is important. And in that environment, the first thing that happens when the interrogation shifts from an interview mode, non-confrontational, to interrogation mode, is a direct accusation that the interrogators believe that you are guilty. Followed quickly by the interrogator's assertion that they have the evidence to prove that you're guilty. Anytime a suspect tries to assert his innocence, interrogators are trained to cut him off. Just wait a minute, Raven. To stick their fingers in his face, and actually physically, singly, not to talk. It's our time to talk. Interrogations are a monologue. They're a monologue by the detective. You don't want the suspect to assert his innocence for you, because the more the suspect asserts his innocence, the more psychologically attached he becomes to the idea that he's innocent. You need to break that, and that's what they do. So, the interrogator dominates the interaction, and they use a variety of techniques, all of which were on display. The first part of the interrogation I showed you was a little long. It was the giving of Miranda warnings. The reason for doing that is to show the shift between the rapport building phase and the confrontational phase. This is where the Miranda warnings are typically given. They're given often just like you saw on that tape. And that was a good giving of Miranda warnings, probably better than you usually see. Because not only do you go over each warning, you even ask the suspect at the end what those warnings meant to him. People waive their Miranda warnings. Whether you're innocent or guilty, they waive their Miranda warnings. 85% of adults waive them. Juveniles waive them at even higher rates. And the reason they waive them is because police officers are trained to get you to waive them, to get you to think that if you assert your rights, you must have something to hide. And the innocent suspect always waives his Miranda warnings because he's got nothing to hide. There are a number of things that happen. One of these is there are certain kinds of questions that take place. You didn't see them in this case in the tape, but they are on the tape. And oftentimes, this is again part of the whole behavior analysis. You ask certain questions, you expect a certain response, if you don't get it, that gives you confidence that you can go forward with a more coercive interrogation. Is there any reason why witnesses will be telling us you were at the crime scene? This kind of a bait question is always given right before the confrontational piece starts. And it gets the suspect to think that the police officers begin have evidence against them and think you might be guilty.